Hey guys, it's Penelope in London, and I've got in front of me the chart of tomorrow, which is going to be the full moon in Capricorn. I'm going to show you my own chart as well, so you can understand how the moon may fall in your own chart and understand aspects briefly. But first of all, we're going to look at this chart, and then I'm going to go through some of my notes. So what we have is, let me get my pointer. Okay. So what we have is that we have the full moon and will be at 3:23:27. And you can see opposite, you've got the sun, which is in the sign of Cancer. So you can see here. And then what the other thing that's going on as well, that we had Jupiter go retrograde a few days ago. So I won't go deeply into that, but Jupiter went retrograde, and that's going on until October. In October this year, we've also got Pluto up here at 26 degrees, and it's opposing Venus at the moment. You can see here, opposition to Venus in the sign of Cancer. And we've got Pluto in Capricorn, its last leg. It's going to go a few more retrogrades, and then it will be going into the sign of Aquarius in 2024, January, for 20 odd years. Then 2024 to 2044. The other thing is that we've got Mercury, and you can see that Mercury is just here. You can see that it's gone direct. It's been retrograde for 3 weeks now, and it's gone direct with this full moon, which is brilliant. And then we've also got the Mercury is going to be squaring Neptune. So it was squaring Neptune a few days that, you know, when we had before it went retrograde, as it was going retrograde. So it's squared, then it went forward, then it's basically going to square again. So I'm going to explain what that means. And then we've also got Saturn here, square to Uranus currently, and that's quite a tight square. And we do have a few nice things going on. We've got this trine, you know, a few trines going on. You can see a kite there actually at that time, which is quite nice. But again, that's including the MC, and this will vary on the ecliptic, depending where we are. So depending where we are in the world, and you're the rising sign at the time of the full moon, different for different areas of the world. So the full moon in Capricorn is tomorrow, 24th, and full moon, and 3:27 degrees. And in California, it's going to be at 11:39 a.m. It's going to be in New York and 14:39 a.m. And it will be in the UK at 19:39 p.m. So if you do your full moon ceremonies or wishes or whatever, you can know what to do there. So it's where we have a strong need for being useful to society. And we may look for justification to the outside world, and we may underestimate what we want for ourselves and for others as well. We may underestimate what we want from ourselves and for others. So we can be shy with this. There may be accompanied by resentment with that as well. And what we mustn't do with this, it's a must not, not a should not, but try not to do, is do not seek approval from the outside. So what we're trying to learn is to not seek approval, be our own boss, you know, be in charge of ourselves, Capricorn, the leader. And we don't want to be seeking outside ourselves, which is the big spiritual lesson quest of being a human on earth. Also, it will, you know, when we seek approval from outside ourselves, we don't always get what we want, and we have to trust our inner values at this time. The other thing I noticed with this is that we've got the I love Black Moon Lilith, and this one is true Lilith here. And what we have going on here is that this is conjunct the node, so this is the North Node. I'm sure this is true Lilith, but it's Black Moon. So what we want to do is really look at this aspect as well, because I'm fascinated that that's also conjunct with Capricorn. We could look also at the 10th house. It's, you know, if we look at the moon in Capricorn, we're looking at the 10th house. It's our public display, and it can be difficult to hide from the facts when this goes on. We've got, you know, we're better off when we've got nothing to hide. Also, it's a public display for better or for worse, and there can be also where we have emotional sensitivity and empathy for others. And we can also you know, this can be to do with our professional life. If we looked at the 10th house as an example, purely what the 10th house means, it's an area of our career, our long-term goals, and what we want to accomplish in the world, and how we want to be seen by others and by the world, and our social standing and our own influence. It's where we're building our legacy, and also sometimes, you know, what we may want to leave behind in the world. You know, if we left, it's like, are we happy with what we're leaving behind? You know, that maybe not everybody thinks that way, but, you know, we're here for a reason. And what would you, how would you want to be remembered? As an example, 10th house, it's a focus on our career and the goals, and also making a commitment to, you know, consistent, because also this is to do, Capricorn is ruled by Saturn, and it's also to do with our commitment and our time and our progress. And it's also here, the 10th house is authority figures, it's law enforcement, teachers, father figures, and the patriarchal rule. So the other thing with Capricorn, I'm going to go on with this Capricorn because it's fascinating, and with that Pluto up there as well. And we've got, you know, it's the social position, it's authority, it's judgment, it's maturity, it's to do with repression, old age, oppression, grief. It can also be to do with discipline, totalitarian, fear, paralysis in the sense of, you know, emotionally, conformity, isolation, and it's man-made law. Sagittarius is natural law, but Capricorn is man-made law. It's also to do with our ancestral tradition and where we can be self-defeating, futility. It's our boundaries as well, because it's the Saturn in there and our structures and form. And it's also politics. And it can also be where we, you know, with depression, because with the Saturn, we can feel that we're restricted. It can be a fall from grace. So think about this with that Pluto up there and how it's been moving through since 2008. And it's coming to its last leg of that. So when I say the last leg, it's I know it's 2021, but it's moving 22, 23, and then 24, it will be in the sign of Aquarius. The other thing with the Sun is in the sign of Cancer, and that will be at 3 degrees. So what does this, you know, mean? It's the moon, you know, it's to do with the moon. It's the ruler of the fourth house is the moon, and Cancer is to do with the moon. So we have the ego, we have security, protection, mother, being Mother Earth, or the archetype of mother, family, it's ancestors, childhood environment, the children. It's what people don't see as well, what goes, you know, it can be our childhood isn't seen, you know, much of what happens. And it's our nurturing, it's protection, it's also neglect, it's our emotions, our self-image. It's where we can be touchy and subjective, and it's to do with gender roles, and it's our inner world, deeply our inner world. So what I'm going to do is go over to, I'm going to come back to this chart, but I'm going to go over to AstroSeek, and I'm going to do a new share. So I'm showing you my chart here. And the reason I'm showing you this is because this is for me, what you can do, this is really good. You can do this because this is a brilliant site. So if you go over to AstroSeek, you can see up here, it's astro.seek.com. I think there's a hyphen there, astro-seek.com. And what you can do is put your time, date, place of birth in, and you do need your time in order to understand where the houses are. If you don't have a birth time, you might need help to try and figure that out. But, you know, with somebody, an astrologer, some astrologers can do that. So then what you would do is that you would, I'm looking at transits. So this is here you see my birth planets here and the degrees. And then what you've got here are the transits. So we know that the full moon is at 1939 in the UK. I've given you the other times pre this for California and for New York. And then what you would do is you see it's 327 degrees. So once you have that, you can see for me that the sun is falling in my eighth house, and it's on Jupiter just there, which is fantastic for me. It's also, it could be either way, actually. And with grandiosity, it could go nuts. But then we've got the moon is in my second house. So if I scroll down, I can see what this moon is doing. So the moon is opposing my Jupiter. It's quintile, which is a spiritual element to my Pluto. And it's also quintile to my Uranus. So you can see here, this here, if you take where that is, that's 72 degrees to here. So that's the spiritualized creative element. And then I've also got the sun conjunct Jupiter. As you can see here, my sun is conjunct Jupiter because we know it's at 3 degrees and my Jupiter is at 3 degrees. And then the moon is sextile to Lilith, and Lilith is the shadow work that we're doing. A sextile is quite a nice combination. And we've got the sun biquintile, which is also spiritualized to my ascendant. So the moon, sextile Lilith. So look, the moon is sextile to my Lilith here. You can see this is, but this Lilith is actually not true Lilith. This Lilith for me is the, I'm forgetting now, it's some Black Moon Lilith. So we have different types of Lilith in the chart. Then we've got the sun is quintile, sorry, no, here. The sun is also biquintile to my ascendant and trine, the sun is trine to Lilith. So the sun is trining to my Lilith here. And the moon, I think we have the moon there. The sun is also biquintile to my ascendant, which is here. So for me, this is quite a nice moon, in my opinion, because, you know, I've got no squares there, but squares really can push us forward. So squares are not bad. They can be very good for us to create and push us into creation. So now I'm going to go back to the Amanita chart here and get my pointer again. And we're going to look at a few more aspects. So you can see that this is the moon, the full moon that we're having. And then what I want to do is look at the Venus-Pluto transit. So this has been going on for a few days. So now if I take this chart and I go, we're going to go hours backwards. We're going to go back. So I'm going to take this chart backwards. And we're going to go, where's Venus gone there? So Venus was exact 2606, 2622. You can see Venus there. 2606. There you go. So this was the 24th, and this is early hours. But this is going to be the 23rd if you're in California or New York, as an example. But Venus opposition Pluto. This is, you know, where we have dealings with relationship drama. There can be drama, obsession and compulsion to do with our attraction and dangerous affairs, you know. So we need to take care with this as this is going on for the next couple of days. And, you know, we can instantly be attracted to somebody as well, but we can have tendency to unpleasantries with this aspect. And also, it can be, there's power play and it's an imbalance that we're looking out for. So if we're conscious, we can watch ourselves where we go with our, however, I'm just going to say that, you know, we're dealing with other people in life. So sometimes, you know, sometimes we'll project onto other people and sometimes they will project onto us our needs. And we need to be open and honest with this aspect. And something I will tell you that from the book of Jeff Wolf Green, which is Pluto One, and I did do a video on this Pluto opposition the other day, so you can go back to a couple of days on my channel and watch this. But on page 282 of Pluto One, which is Jeff Wolf Green, it basically with this Pluto opposition to Venus, on page 282, he's basically saying that all potential problems and karmic situations can be instantly progressively metamorphosized once these individuals learn to relate to themselves outside of a relationship and to identify and supply their own needs. Essential self-relatedness and self-love will eliminate the need to project unrealistic needs and expectations onto the other. In addition, these individuals will learn how to encourage and support independence and self-reliance in their partners rather than trying to control them. The intent of the confrontations which occur, so let's say that we have confrontations occurring, that the intent of confrontations which occur in the relationship is to promote the learning here. Once these people stop looking outside of themselves and for the meaning of their lives, they will be able to choose and commit themselves, you know, to a partner or people who reflect their own higher evolutionary and karmic needs. Also, once the energies of the Venus, Pluto aspects are metamorphosized, these individuals become not only the closest and most trusted and loyal friends or lovers, but also individuals who support and encourage the needs of others to transform the limitations and blockages of their own lives in order to be free. So freedom, you know, is a funny thing because we look to others for our freedom, but ultimately the freedom that we seek is inner, you know, in any situation we're in, you know, not all, I'm not going to do a spiritual bypass on this because some people are in very difficult situations, but overall, when we're in some sense of safety and we're having our basic needs met, then we, you know, we're able to look at our consciousness, even when we're in very tricky situations, because I know I've had dark nights of the soul in my own life. You know, it's not whatever appearances we give out on social media or in life, you know, it's a snapshot and a moment of what people perceive us to be. And some of the depths that we've been having to go through the whole COVID thing and generally in our lives, even in our early childhood. And when you think that Venus is in the sign of Cancer, it's going to be moving into Leo in the coming days, which will be great. And we'll find out if it's going to be great, depending on what it's up to. But it will also be meeting with Mars in the coming week or so. What I'm very interested in as well is to look at this black moon and the node. And the other thing I would say is that we will look at the Neptune, because this can be very confusing for us, this Neptune. The Neptune Mercury can be quite hard work, but I was fascinated by this North Node conjunct the, we're going to go, I went forward, so let's just see this. I'm going to go forward, we're going to get that moon lined up again, because we've got that Lilith is retrograde, so we can see there it's retrograde at the moment, and we're going to go hours forward. And we're going to line up that moon to 3 degrees again, 3:37, 39, was it 37 or 39? Or go back, 3:27, that's it. So we can see that's lined up and we can see there that this is literally, we've got this conjunction with the North Node and Lilith. So what does this mean? So black moon conjunct the North Node. And this is the definition. Until the core fear of the black moon is recognized, we have substantial difficulty identifying our life path. Most astrologers take the view that the lessons of the South Node must be integrated before we can activate the North Node. And this is even more important when the black moon conjuncts or opposes the North Node. And then also the transiting black moon to a North Node. And when this goes on, we begin to experience a dramatic change or a breakdown in some area of life that is blocking the path of what is in our highest and best interest. Obstacles to our destiny begin to fall away. We feel the need to move beyond the restrictions of the past. And although this is often challenging, hindsight will reveal how the changes were necessary to allow other events to unfold. So I can see, you know, this is really in alignment with what's going on right now. You know, we're basically being challenged, and with hindsight, it will reveal how the changes were necessary in order to allow for other events to unfold. So we need to fulfill our destiny, and it looks like that Black Moon Lilith has got in there with that form, with this full moon as well. The other thing that I wanted to say was this Mercury, Neptune. Oh, the other thing, Neptune is about to go retrograde in the coming few days. We'll have a quick look at that. And then the Mercury square Neptune. So watch here, Mercury, and watch this Neptune. Sorry, watch Mercury here. So we're going to go days ahead. And we're going to go 1, 2, 3. We're going to get that Mercury to 23 degrees. 1, 2, 3. There you go. So Mercury will be in a square with Neptune here. And what this means is that it can distort our thinking and confuse and complicate discussions and business dealings. It's also, you know, when we're either giving or receiving instructions, there can be a lack of clarity, misinterpretation. We see a lot of that going on. We've seen that go on throughout the last few weeks anyway, and generally through probably the last year realistically. And we want to make sure that we seek advice before we do anything, you know, big. And also we need to stick to our basics in communication while this is going on, because our imagination can lead us to deception and sticky situations, and also we can feel insecure with this transit. So we must avoid being, you know, the scandals and whatever. And also we don't want to lie about things because, you know, if we fib, then it can lead to embarrassment. And also there can be cover-ups with this. And we've also got, you know, conspiracy theories or spiritual and religious views can be involved in this as well. And it's very subjective because that Mercury is in the sign of Gemini. And also we want to stick to activities that are going to work with that. So with the Neptune, we'd be better off to, you know, either journaling, doing poetry, just doing artistic things, and, you know, stay, communicate in a different way, you know, use the communication to communicate in a different way. And I think that, so there you go. So that Neptune also on the 6th of July, we're going to go back here. So we can see that that Mercury is moving on in, it's already in a square, literally moving, it's applying at this time. But we're going to go back now to today, which is the 24th, and you can see Neptune is here, and we're going to go days ahead to see when that goes retrograde. So it stations on the 25th, and then it's still stationed, and then it goes retrograde on the 27th. Okay, so on the 27th of June, and that will go retrograde for 5 months. I haven't got the exact date in front of me, or I did have, but I haven't got it in front of me, but I did have. So, oh yes, found it. So that's going to go retrograde until December, and it will go back to 20 degrees of Pisces. So that's on my IC at the moment. So I've been having a lot of fun with that. I've been getting used to, you know, just being going with the flow. That's what I've been doing. So that's it. I'm going to leave it there. You've got any questions, or you've got any other thing that you've seen on this chart that you'd like to point out, then you can let me know. And have a great Capricorn full moon. Catch you later.